Good morning. You know, this summer, when it's really nice and warm and all the snow is gone, it's sort of like the school when you have snow days. We are going to have days this summer when I expect you to put off vacation just so you can come and make up for your snow days. But all of you will be okay. Because you were here on a snow day, so you'll still get to go. But we'll put out the memo for everybody else. And I just, you know, just be so careful out there. I hear there's a couple people slipped already. That ice is just absolutely terrible. So be careful. Thank you for braving this nasty, icy stuff that's out there. But do be careful as you plan for breakfast or to go home or whatever it is you have for the rest of your day. Very special welcome to you if you happen to be a guest or a visitor with us today. And if you're a first-time visitor, we'd be delighted to be able to welcome you more formally if you would be willing to stand up and introduce yourself. Do we have any first-time visitors with us this morning? I'm going to turn your attention then to your bulletin. Altar flowers today given by Peter and Linda Codius in honor of their 46th wedding anniversary. We thank you, Peter and Linda. And Slick, how you doing? I'm going to have you, David, just share a few words with you in regard to the, once again, the upcoming Passion for Life Music Adventure.
Passion for Life Music Adventure is the rebranding of our Music and Fine Arts series. Will be now called Passion for Life. And on February 12th, we're going to have a musical adventure that will incorporate both classical, contemporary, and secular music. On the far end, in the Fellowship Hall, Kenny James and Johan and his group will be performing music of both the church and the world. Down here, we'll have a Native American flute. We'll have a women's quartet, Sweet Adeline's, and then our own ALC groups will be performing, but it may not be necessarily the music you're used to hearing in worship by our groups. It's kind of like an Acro Night at ALC, and we're using this as a fundraiser to raise funds for the Fine Arts program so we can bring people in and we don't have to charge ticket prices, or when we do, we can offset it with the fund. We're going to have some good finger food, so if nothing else, come for that. And the best part is there's no football that day because the season will be over. So come on out and have a great afternoon of music and food and fellowship and support the arts here at ALC.
Thank you, David. At this time, I would invite you to go ahead and stand as you are able. We'll quiet our minds, center our hearts, and prepare to come into the worship of our Lord.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we live again as your children. Amen. Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us his beloved children. Hear God say to us now, our sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The true light that enlightens everyone has come into the world. God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Lord God, your loving kindness always goes before us and follows after us. Summon us into your light and direct our steps in the ways of goodness that comes from the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, beginning at the first verse. But there will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the fourth chapter. Now when Jesus heard that John the Baptist had been arrested, he withdrew into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region of and shadow of death, on them light has dawned. Now from this time, Jesus began to preach, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And while walking by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed Jesus. And going on from there, Jesus saw two other brothers, James, and the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets, and Jesus called them. And immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, we're now fairly embedded in the new year. For many of us, we have reached that moment of truth. That is, for those of us who have made one or more New Year's resolutions. And, of course, what is the most common New Year's resolution? What do you think it is? Lose weight or, and, or get in better shape. And if you've had any doubt about that, just think about television and the onslaught of commercials that come on in regard to weight loss programs or also fitness equipment. Getting into better physical shape is, of course, important. Science has told us, we know, that extra pounds are a major health concern. We know that they can lead to heart disease, diabetes, even stroke. So losing weight is something that's definitely on my radar, which has only been intensified, I think, in the last couple years by my rheumatoid arthritis. It's, you know, the can I, like so many of you, have been sort of just kicking down the road and kicking down the road, and finally God just hit me between the eyes with a 2x4 and said, "You know, Jack, I think it's time to get a little more serious about this." So I've jumped into that group with many of you that said, you know, this is the year that I'm finally really going to get serious about this, at least for another week or so. And then February comes and we'll see what happens. But I want you to know, if you are one of those folks who is struggling with the whole weight issue and being out of shape and that, I definitely feel your pain. But I want to know if you have seriously thought about the shape you are in spiritually. I wish that for every person who made a New Year's resolution to get into better physical shape, there were at least 10 people who had decided to get serious about getting into better spiritual shape. The truth is, each of us is being spiritually shaped. We're being shaped from the moment we are born until the moment we die, and we're being spiritually shaped by God, and we're being spiritually shaped for God's purposes. Like I said, this is throughout our life, and it's happening to us whether we realize it or not, and whether we admit it or not. God is constantly at work in our lives, shaping us spiritually. For instance, Jesus gathered fishermen, we know, to be his disciples. So the question could be, long before those fishermen mentioned today, Andrew, Peter, James, John, long before they met Jesus, could it be possible that God was already working in their life, shaping them for the ministry that was coming? And I think most of us would recognize, yeah, that's true. And I want you to think about that. I want you to think about commercial fishermen and some of the things that are important to commercial fishermen as far as their skill set and their personality and that sort of thing. Commercial fishermen certainly have to be self-motivated. Most of them are self-employed, or they're working for, you know, someone who's got a boat. Nobody is going to, you know, make them go out and you know, into the sea and fish and under some really extreme circumstances. I mean, they've got to get up early, you know, at the crack of dawn or long before dawn, and get to their boats and get their boats ready to go. You know, it's cold, it's wet, it's damp. They better be pretty motivated if you're going to go into that line of work. And if you're going to go into that line of work, you got to be willing to work hard. And you got to be willing to put in some long hours. And you have to be willing to do that under some pretty extreme and sometimes, yes, even dangerous conditions. If you're going to be a commercial fisherman, you have to be patient. You have to be determined. You have to basically be a kind of an optimistic person if you ever hope to be successful. So think of all those characteristics and then ask yourself, weren't those really the same characteristics that were going to be needed for those first disciples? They were going to have to be self-motivated. They were going to have to be hardworking, fearless, optimistic. They were going to need to be patient. They were going to need to be determined if they were going to be successful as disciples. So what I'm suggesting to you is that God had a plan, and that God was shaping Peter, Andrew, James, and John to fit into that plan long before they even realized what God was up to in their lives. And so the question is, could the same be true for you? Could God be, right now, and has he been throughout the past, shaping you for a particular ministry that may not even be revealed to you yet, or may not even be revealed to you for some time? We know, because Scripture tells us this in Romans chapter 8, that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God. And you know from your own life that word everything sure encompasses a lot of stuff, a lot of life experiences, some positive, some negative. And what the Scripture says is all this stuff you're going through in life, God is using all of those things to ultimately achieve his purpose. Just as with Peter, Andrew, James, and John, God is shaping your life for the ministry that he wants you to do. And God deliberately shapes every person in this room in order to serve him. Here's the challenge. Our challenge is to figure out, what is our spiritual shape? What's God been up to in our life so that we can try to determine how God wants to use us as we go forward? To help you understand your spiritual shape, I've turned to one of my favorite authors and certainly one of my favorite spiritual mentors, Pastor Rick Warren. Interesting thing about Rick Warren, he wrote this book called The Purpose-Driven Life. Since then, it's been retooled into something I think it's called What on Earth Am I Here For? The interesting thing is, for me, that The Purpose-Driven Life is the best-selling book in the world, second only to the Bible. I mean, that's a remarkable thing. The best-selling book in the world is a book about discipleship and about faith, and I don't think that's an accident. And it's been around for a while. Like I said, it's been retooled, but much like the Scripture, the truths that it shares are timeless. I'm going to share some of that with you. I wish I had thought of all this stuff myself, Actually, I wish I'd written that book myself. But alas, no, I'm not getting any royalties from this. But if you look in your bulletin, you will see that your spiritual shape really includes several different things. And Rick has used these letters from the word shape to identify those. So you have S-H-A-P-E. For S, you have spiritual gifts. For H, heart. For A, accessibility. For P, personality. For E, experience. So let's just quickly go through some of this. This morning I want to help each of you to better understand your spiritual shape and help you to begin to think about how you can use or apply your spiritual shape to become an instrument of God's plan to transform the world, just as he did for Peter and Andrew and James and John. So we begin with the letter S in shape, and that is, of course, your spiritual gifts. Now, as much as we might like to, the fact of the matter is we cannot manufacture a spiritual gift. I mean, that's the whole point of the name, spiritual gift. You can't earn it, you can't manufacture it. If you have a spiritual gift, it's because God has given it to you. And that's, I always kind of get into this thing of when people talk about the spiritual gifts, and one of the spiritual gifts is speaking in tongues. And there are some denominations that say, well, you're not really a believer if you don't speak in tongues. I think that's nonsense. Because a spiritual gift is simply this, a gift from God. And some, he gives the gift of tongues, it says, and some, he gives instead the gift of the discernment of tongues. And so, don't buy into that nonsense. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that you have to have a particular spiritual gift in order to be saved. That's a human invention. God chooses the spiritual gifts you have. You can sit here, if your spiritual gift is not speaking in tongues, you can sit here all day long and pray about it and go off into your closet and try to speak in tongues or whatever. If that's not God's desire for you, it isn't going to happen. So a spiritual gift is exactly that. Something that God gives specifically to you so that you can carry out a particular ministry. And the interesting thing is, God always chooses exactly who gets what gifts. And because God loves variety, no single gift is given to everyone, nor does any individual receive all of the spiritual gifts. And the reason why we don't receive all of the spiritual gifts is God wants us to work together. God wants us to depend upon one another. So he's always going to leave you lacking in a gift so that you realize you are dependent upon someone else who's different than you that has that gift. So, what is it? The sum of our parts is greater than the individual parts or something like that. You know that, how that goes. Now, this is very important. God did not give you any of your spiritual gifts for your own benefit. And oftentimes, that's where sin kind of works into the whole spiritual gift thing is. We have a particular spiritual gift, and then we use that gift, and then we use it for our own glory. I mean, you take Rick Warren's whole deal with the Purpose-Driven Life book. He had this gift of writing, of being able to discern God's will, to put this masterful book together, and he could have used all of that for his own self-glorification. The interesting thing about Rick Warren is he's a reverse tither. A lot of people don't understand that. In other words, Rick Warren keeps 10% of the profits from that book for himself. The other 90% he gives to the church and to its mission, which is why if you ever get a chance to see Saddleback Church in Southern California, it's just an unbelievably beautiful a campus, but they're doing just tremendous things in expanding ministry around the world with the amount of money that they make off of this book that Rick Warren wrote. But he understands the spiritual gift wasn't for his own benefit. It was for the blessing of the ministry of the gospel. So God did not give you a spiritual gift for your own benefit. 1 Corinthians, it says, to each is given the manifestation of the Spirit. So each of us is given a spiritual gift, always for the common good. Your spiritual gift is to be used for the common good, not for your own personal gain. However, for you to be able to use whatever spiritual gift you have, the first thing is you got to figure out what it is. And you might remember that several months ago we were encouraging people. Many of you know what your spiritual gifts are, and you're already involved in ministry using those spiritual gifts, and that's great. Some of you are still wondering, what is my spiritual? And so there's wonderful things on the internet. You can get on there and take spiritual gifts inventories. The congregation, the church office has spiritual gifts inventories. We can get you. You can come talk to one of your pastors, that sort of thing. We'll make sure, if you're not sure what your spiritual gift is, we'll help you to figure that out. Because that's the beginning. You, to understand you have the gift, but you may not yet know what it is. So spiritual gifts are very important, discernment of those. The second part of your spiritual shape is what Rick Warren calls your heart. And he talks about something called your spiritual heartbeat. Scripture, the heart has always been symbolic of our desires, our hopes, our interests, our dreams, our ambitions, our affections. Scripture says, as a face is reflected in water, so the heart reflects the person. And in Scripture it says in 1 Samuel, serve the Lord faithfully with all your heart. So what are they talking about? Well, God has given each of us a unique spiritual heartbeat. What do I mean by that? Simply what it means is you feel passionately about certain things. Some things just flip your switch. Some things just get you excited. They might not excite me, but they're the kinds of things that excite you. So we need to pay close attention to our spiritual heartbeat. We need to pay attention to those things that God puts in our heart that we feel passionate about. And we need to search our heart for those things, and so that we can identify those passions and steer them into godly service. So think about the stuff that really flips your switch and floats your boat and gets you excited. That's probably where God is steering you in your ministry. The third part of your spiritual shape is recognizing what God has made accessible to you. That's the A. In other words, who or what is your mission field? And we all have a mission field. God has someone, something in mind for us to use our spiritual gifts and our spiritual passions to make a difference in the world. Jesus says that we're supposed to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. So we know that we have this great commission, but who is God making accessible to us? And the important thing for us to understand is you don't have to go to the far ends of the earth in order to find your mission field. Now, if that is your passion, and if you have the spiritual gift of evangelism, in particular, then that may be what God has in mind for you. But more likely, your mission field is going to be much, much, much closer to home. And that's the point I want to make. Spirituality has to begin at home. In Matthew chapter 18, something interesting happened. Jesus is talking with some people, and he sees a child, and he calls the child up, and he places the child in the midst of this crowd that he's talking to, and he says, whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. So what he's basically saying is, first and foremost, our evangelism list begins very close to home, and in particular with children. So now I'm focusing on parents in particular. And I want parents to understand that your mission field, first and foremost, always is your own family, your own children. But here's the thing. Some of you say, yeah, my kids are grown up and gone now. Here's the deal. There's not a time limit on when you get to quit evangelizing your children. They are your children as long as you are alive, right? As long as they are alive. So as long as you are alive and your children are alive, they are your spiritual responsibility. Now, sometimes that gets flipped around. I was raised in an unchurched home. Well, guess what? Well, all right, that's just the way the cards were dealt. My spiritual responsibility then became, as a child, to evangelize my parents. The interesting thing is, family, which is our closest mission field, is oftentimes our most difficult mission field, isn't it? And I think it's because we know our family knows us best. And, the thought, especially me, when I was such a hellion as a kid and all that, can you imagine how my parents, well, maybe you can't imagine, how my parents felt when I gave them that phone call and said, I'm quitting my job, I'm giving up everything, and what I'm going to go do is I'm going to go back to seminary and I'm going to become a Lutheran minister. My parents absolutely freaked out. Just flipped out. Now, my in-laws were thrilled. They were lifelong Lutherans, you know. I mean, this was like as good as having a doctor in the family, which they already had one of those. So now they really scored big because they had a pastor in the family. You know, my father-in-law, God bless him, I would go in and Luann and I would be together and he would introduce, this is my son-in-law, Jack, the Lutheran pastor. And Luann would be standing right there, you know, and he didn't even introduce his own daughter, you know. Oh, and by the way, this is my daughter, Luann. You know, I mean, it was, but my parents were totally freaked out. They were afraid that I was going to bring home the Bible, throw it down on the table, start thumping on it, start, pointing the finger and saying, why aren't you going to church? Why aren't you doing this? You know, And then, knowing the hellion I'd been and the life that I had lived, and, I felt a little bit hypocritical. Now I'm sharing with my parents the gospel, and it's a difficult thing. You know what I'm talking about. You know when your kids grow up and they go away and they don't want to listen to you and you don't know how far to push it and you don't want to turn them off. It's a delicate dance. I understand that. I just want you to understand the dance never ends. I know it's very delicate, but it never ends. Your brothers, your sisters, churched or unchurched, it never ends. Family is family. God has put you in the midst of that. That is your primary mission field. Good luck figuring that one out. But practice makes perfect. But then it goes out from there. You have neighbors. You have co-workers. You have, other people that God has put into your sphere of influence. This is the accessibility portion. This is what God is saying. I've planted in your heart a passion for the Lord. I've given you spiritual gifts. This is your mission field. You can't run from it. You can't hide from it. It is what it is. Andrew, in Scripture, a little bit different reading, in John's calling of the disciples, it says that Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the first who heard John's testimony. John the Baptist has said, there is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And Andrew was one of John the Baptist's disciples. And so he went and he spent an evening with Jesus and got all excited. What's the first thing he did? He went to his brother Peter, said, Peter, we have found the Messiah. I mean, that's his mission field. That right there, he didn't right away run off to Jerusalem and say, we found the Messiah. He went to his mission field, his brother. And then it says in Scripture, Andrew brought his brother to Jesus. Now, it's the Holy Spirit is the one who's ultimately going to move in the hearts of those you love. Okay, I want you to understand that. You can't make them believe, but you do have a responsibility to lead the horse to water. Okay, so keep that in mind, and I know that's very challenging. It's challenging for me as well. The next piece is the P of shape, and that is personality. When God made each of us, he broke the mold. And that's pretty clear. I mean, if you look around this room, no two exact people thinking exactly alike and that sort of thing. God loves variety. And so what that means is that God made some of us introverts, and God made some of us extroverts. Some of us are thinkers, and some of us are feelers, and some of us are doers. Some of us work better alone. Some of us work better as a part of a team. But each of us has given our unique personality, and God says, I want you to work within that personality. And if you wonder how that works, just look at the disciples. So if you look at the disciples, you had Peter, pretty reactionary, pretty out there, leadership qualities. You had John, the beloved disciple, but boy, he was there at the cross. He didn't maybe have, you know, he wasn't as outgoing as Peter, but he was there to care for Jesus' mother and be there at the cross and be the one called the beloved disciple. We know that Simon, he was called Simon the Zealot. He was zealous for the faith. Okay, he's one of these people on fire for Jesus that goes down to the courthouse lawn and says, you know, do you know where you're going to be, you know, after this life? You know, well, that's not maybe what you would want, but that's the kind of guy Simon was. Matthew, very analytical. You look at Thomas. Thomas, a deep thinker. He likes to work things through. He likes to process it. James, we know that not only was James' mother ambitious, he was pretty ambitious as well. So all these different personalities, and God called them all, and they were all used by God for his glory to bring different kinds of people into the realm of God's kingdom. You have your own personality. You don't have to be somebody you're not. Just be who you are. And it's interesting how when God puts you in your mission field, you don't have to worry about the words you're going to say. God will put the words upon your heart so that you can share them. I tell people, really, you know, you don't have to quote scripture, miles and miles of scripture. That doesn't impress a whole lot of people. But you can talk to people about what your life was like. And what your life is like now that Christ is in your heart and how that's given you hope and strength. You can talk to people about your experiences and what you've been through and how God has given you strength. Those things aren't threatening to other people. That's interesting stuff for other people. That's why I love it when people give testimonies and that sort of thing. So you have your own unique personality. Use that personality for the glory of God. The final thing is experiences. We are shaped by our experiences. Each of us has gone through life in a different way. We have the good, we have the bad. For some of us, the ugly. And for most of us, the ugly. All of these things, all of these experiences shape us into the person that we are today. And we can use those experiences for the glory of God. I like the saying, what will I do with what I've been through? Okay, you've all been through it. Now, God says, what are you going to do with what you've been through? I look at my own life, you know, and I'm not raised in a churched home. Okay, I've had that experience. So I understand people who weren't raised in a churched home and the struggles that go with that. My experience as an alcoholic and a drug addict has given me unique opportunities to share and witness with alcoholics and drug addicts or family members of alcoholics and drug addicts. I worked as a mental health counselor for a number of years in chemical dependency treatment programs. I didn't become a believer till I was 27, so I understand the whole born again thing and that. So that's my own unique experience. All of these things have profoundly affected me, and God gives me opportunities to use that. Now, my wife's very different. Her experience very different than mine, and she approaches it in a different way. God has used and will continue to use your experiences to help you not only to grow as a Christian, but also to be able to minister to others. What will you do with what you've been through? Aldous Huxley says, experience is not what happens to you, it's what you do with what happens to you. What you do with what happens to you. So what I want you to understand is that you are being shaped by God right now, and you have been, and He will continue to shape you. God shapes each of us for the ministry He has planned for us. You have your spiritual shape, I have mine. As we've looked at these ways that God shapes us for service, I hope you might have a deeper appreciation for how God has a plan for you and how He's working that plan out to prepare you for your mission. Using our spiritual shape is the secret of ultimately, says Rick Warren, it is the secret for finding fulfillment in life. It's the secret for finding our purpose in life. And we will be most effective when we use our spiritual gifts and our opportunities in the area of our heart's desire, our passions, in a way that best expresses our personality and our experiences. The bottom line is, the better the fit, the more successful we will be. My prayer for you is that you will continue to explore how God has shaped you, that you will celebrate that you will be thankful and grateful in your heart for the shape you are, not try to be somebody you aren't, and then open your heart, open your life to let God use you for His glory. And then when He gives you the opportunity, get ready to go to work. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. At this time, I would invite you to go ahead and stand as you're able. We'll sing our hymn of the day, which is, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light. That's in the blue hymnals, number 649.
Let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward to receive our tithes and offerings. We do this in response to God's riches at Christ's expense.
Oh,
to be a light to the nations. Let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. Father God, forgive us for believing in our own independence to the point of exempting you from our daily lives. We pray that all we do and all that we say would be pleasing in your sight, Lord. Your precious Son has set us free to be children of the promise, but we are also your servants. We seek to glorify you by our words and our deeds. Give each of us a fresh revelation of what you would have us do through the spiritual gifts that you have blessed us with. For with you, all things are possible. Hear us, O God. Lamb of God, there is mercy and healing in the power of your blood. Cover those who are sick and dying with your powerful love. Protect our servicemen and women, and give comfort to their families. Console all who are grieving, lonely, hungry, homeless, or suffering in any way. We pray for all those who are in need of your healing touch, as we name them in our hearts at this time. Hear us, O God. Most Holy Father, we pray for your mercy to cover our nation, our president, and all the branches of government. Give all in government true servants' hearts that desire to sincerely labor for the common good, compassionate hearts to restore our nation, and forgiving hearts that lift up and encourage one another to work for our country, united under your blessing and guidance. Hear us, O God. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Receive the Lord's blessing. May the God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.